Hi, this is Phil Cameron. I'm the pastor of Risen Savior Lutheran Church. How would your life look if you could resolve conflict? How would your family look if you could resolve conflict? How would our country look if it could resolve conflict? I'm waiting. Can you even picture any area of your life that is without conflict? If I gave you a few minutes to come up with a picture in your mind, could you describe it? Max Lucado said this, "Conflict is inevitable, but combat is optional. Conflicts are within and without." And Thomas Crum said it this way, "The quality of our lives depends not on whether or not we have conflicts, but on how we respond to them." Disagreements and debate on important issues can be healthy and helpful. Fighting is not. Sadly, it is hard to have a peaceful discussion of important issues. The old adage is more true than I would like to admit. It goes this way, 10% of conflicts are due to differences of opinion. 90% are due to the wrong tone of voice. I ended last week's message with Romans chapter 12, verse 18. It says this, "If possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all." This verse is so important and informative about conflict resolution. It blows up some false and sadly popular views within the Christian community. Some people believe that we should all be at peace. You hear it said this way, "Can't we all get along?" The answer, sadly, is no. The verse starts off, "if it is possible." And it may not be possible. You are only one person in the conflict process. You can't control what the other person may choose. It may not be possible to live peacefully. The sad reality is that there are antagonists in our lives, in the world and in our country, and in our community and in our workplaces, and even in our families. Who are antagonists? Antagonists, by definition, are individuals who, on the basis of non-substantive evidence, go out of their way to make insatiable demands, usually attacking the person or performance of others. These attacks are selfish in nature, tearing down rather than building up. Biblically, we are to handle conflict with the people we interact with by using the yugo principle. Now, those of you who are my age or so might remember that the yugo was a small car made in the former nation of Yugoslavia that survives in the American consciousness as the ultimate automotive failure. Poorly engineered, ugly, and cheap, it survived much longer as punchlines for comedians than it did as a vehicle on the roads. Well, the yugo car might not get you safely and effectively where you want to go, but Jesus was a proponent of the yugo principle. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 5 and in chapter 18 these things, "If your brother has offended you, or if you've offended your brother, then you go. You go to that person and seek reconciliation." This is how God dealt with the conflict we had caused by our sin and rebellion against Him. He didn't avoid the conflict. God didn't explode in anger and violence, but put the yugo principle into practice. God said to Jesus, "You go." John chapter 3, verse 16, which we quote all the time, says this, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him should not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send His Son into the world to judge the world, but that the world might be saved through Him." And by Christ's death and by Christ's resurrection, we now have peace with God. That is, we have a right relationship with God. God doesn't want conflict between Him and us, nor does God want conflict between you and me and others. Instead, Jesus wants His disciples to be peacemakers. In a world that's hungry for peace, we must choose to work through conflict in our personal relationships. Jesus says in Matthew chapter 5, verse 9, "Blessed are the peacemakers." I can imagine that sounded completely pathetic to the people in Jesus' day, and it probably sounds pretty pathetic to us too. The audience that heard those words from Jesus were being oppressed by the conquering Roman army and empire. Yet Jesus said, "Blessed are the peacemakers." Key to this word peace is the word shalom. The Old Testament word shalom was core to Jewish identity of that day. And basically, it's the idea of completeness, of fullness. It means all relationships working in right and proper order. Everything as God had made it and intended it to be. The fullest expression of everything being right with the world. So peace, or shalom, as Jesus meant it, is not the absence of conflict. It's actually humanity flourishing at its fullest. The world is broken, and Jesus has called us to put it back together, to put the pieces back together for His glory to make peace in our world. Our usual understanding of peace is a bit different. We think we're making peace when we avoid conflict whenever possible, but that's not actually peace. That's false peace. My first sermon I ever preached was in a foreign language, in a deaf church, in sign language. I don't remember much about my sign language or that sermon, but this peace, shalom, is still in my mind. It's that right relationship with God and others and all of creation. The work of peacemaking is what Jesus wants us to be about. When Jesus said, "Blessed are the peacemakers," He was inviting us to an incredibly difficult and challenging process that starts in our own hearts. Being a peacemaker does not mean compromising between right and wrong. Christians define what is right or wrong in terms of what God wills. What God wills is rooted in His moral nature and revealed in the Bible, God's Word. Please note that Jesus is the Prince of Peace, but He did not compromise the truth with the religious leaders of His day. He confronted them and was in clear conflict with them. There's a cynical response that people sometimes use in an argument. They say, "Well, I could agree with you, but then we'd both be wrong." Jesus would not agree with the religious authorities because then they'd all be wrong. We too must stand strong for God's word and declare what is right and wrong, and then share the gospel of Jesus Christ. Sadly, I must add one more element to this discussion. Much of what I said is applicable to our normal relationships that have entered into conflict. But these are normally non-violent conflicts. If bodily harm is threatened, we are permitted to protect ourselves and our loved ones. The commandment from Exodus chapter 20 is usually translated as, "You shall not kill." But the Hebrew word for killing is not used, but the Hebrew word for murder is. Jesus uses the word for murder in reference to this commandment as well. Let me give you an illustration. A bear breaking into my house is about to do harm and kill me and my family. I have no bad feelings about bears. I don't hate bears. But I do want to stop the bear's destructive and dangerous behavior. I will use whatever means to love my family and protect them. I will shoot and kill the bear to stop his actions and protect my family. I did not murder the bear, but I did kill the bear. In the same way, if a person breaks into my house to do bodily harm to me or my family, I will do my best to protect me and my family. I have no feelings toward this person, but only want to stop his threatening and dangerous behavior. I will use whatever means necessary to protect the lives of my family. I may need to kill the intruder to stop his evil behavior, but I did not murder. It would have been nice to have made peace with this person, but that option was not available. Our Lord's will for our lives is to be peacemakers. So back to Romans chapter 12, verse 18. If it is possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. As Jesus' disciples, we are to be peacemakers insofar as it depends on us. So we ask these questions. What can we do to better understand the other person's position? Can we see things from their perspective? Are we seeking first to understand before we are understood? Are we coming from a position of helping and caring about the other person? Do we have peace in our own hearts? It is one of the better known passages of scriptures, "Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus." That's from Philippians chapter 4. This sounds easy enough. Prayer plus thanksgiving equals peace. Go through the steps and you get peace. Then why doesn't the formula work? When I am anxious, I pray, but my mind keeps drifting back to the anxious circumstances, and before I know it, I am trying to solve the problem. After again confessing my distractibility, I get back to praying, only to have the cycle continue. Thinking I might do better at Thanksgiving, I write out a Thanksgiving list, but the list rarely dislodges my anxiety, and for good reason. No matter how long the list is, there is no guarantee that I will be spared my most recent doomsday scenarios. Now what? I just tried one of the classic passages on anxiety and it didn't work. Aha, there is a clue. I was looking for a pill. I visited God, my pharmacist, and asked what to take for my anxiety. That's not the way scripture works. I should have noticed it when I reduced the passage to a formula. Scripture instead is about the triune God. It is about knowing and trusting a person, and our formulas can actually turn us away from that person and cause us to rely on a series of steps and rules. Go back and look for the Prince of Peace. Commands such as "do not be anxious" typically come after a reason why we don't have to be anxious. In this case, the reason was slipped into the preceding verse. The Lord is at hand in Philippians chapter 4, verse 5. That changes everything. The emphasis is not on how we pray or how much thanks we give. It is on the God who has come close to us, who hears and who is with us. If Jesus is with us, we can pray, give thanks, and have peace in our hearts. And then we can be the peacemakers he asks us to be. Amen.